Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's start with a prayer, guys. Father in heaven, you are in all places and you are at all times. And yet you have told us that there is a special way in which you're present when people gather in your name to hear from you and to praise you and just to be near you and be together. And so we know, Father, that you are here in a special way now, and we ask you to do whatever work you want to do in each of us, because we know that you desire the best for us, and you have good in your heart toward us. And so enable us by your Holy Spirit just to be open to whatever it is you want to do in and through us today as we gather to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand as we begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You are, I am, who I will be made.
The reading for this morning is from Matthew, chapter 5, verses 21 to 33. Or at least turn toward the screen.
going to show you there's a movie.
Those are ducks, by the way, in case you can't quite tell yet. Anyone feeling tension? Show you a movie where ducks get
run over.
Oh,
there they go.
You just know they're going to be water. That's even up there.
Yeah,
there's
going to be water here somewhere.
All right. So, this is the children's message. This is the children's message. That video is your life. Sometimes your life is going to be cool. It's going to be going okay, like on one side of the road. And then things are going to get rough for a while. Sometimes you're going to feel like you're blown away. Sometimes, maybe you've already felt that way sometimes. It can be a little scary going into a new school or a new grade. Or maybe you didn't get as good a grade on a test as you wanted or something. And that's like, it's like those little duckies getting blown away. But the message is this. They made it across the road purely because they stuck with their mom. And you're going to make it right if you stick with Jesus. He's going to guide you through everything. Those ducks had no idea what they were going through, little duckies, but evidently the mom duck did. And when you go through life, you have no idea what you're going to be going through later in life, but Jesus does. And so if you follow him, he's going to get you through it. Yes? Well, none of them got hit. The little ones that got, like, scattered, that was just the wind. They all made it safe. You know, alright, so that's your whole children's lesson right there. Stick with Jesus for your whole life. Because whenever you feel blown away, just turn back to Jesus and keep following. And he's going to get you through it, okay? Alright. Robin.
Good morning, everybody. Just a reminder about the Greek. Fill out the front side and put your name and address and I'll move. Other side, fill out any prayers and requests, and we bring them up with your offerings. Visitors to us, there's no obligation to give an offering, but those of us who are members, it takes money to run the church, so let's make sure we give and give generously. Let's bow our heads and pray. Almighty gracious and loving Lord, we thank you all for this opportunity to come together this morning to worship you. Reinforcing that feeling that Jesus, you're always with us, that you are there for us at all times. Just open up our hearts and our minds to hear the message that you are proclaiming through Pastor John's word. Pray these things in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. So, the duck movie. I would say to you that life is a lot like the duck movie. In fact, that duck movie has everything, it portrays everything we face. In life, we have basically three kinds of problems, issues that we want to solve. We have internal issues and problems and things we need to deal with and solve. We have external things and problems and issues to deal with that we need to solve. And we have cosmic or philosophical problems that we need to deal with and solve. And so, like, I'm looking at the ducks, and the external problem for the ducks is, I need to get across the road, right? The internal problem for the duck is, do I have what it takes? Who should I follow to get across the road? Can I trust the person leading me across the road? And clearly the duckies said yes. And of course, there's the cosmic or philosophical problem of why did the chicken cross the dot? Anyway, so yeah, that's the bad joke. Welcome to Journey of Life Church of Bad Jokes. We have the same three kind of problems. We have what's going on inside of us. We have our internal problems. We have our external problems. This sort of problems right in front of us that need to be solved, work, home, family, that kind of thing. And then we all have to deal with cosmic problems, philosophical problems. What is life about? Good versus evil, the meaning of life. Those are the kind of things that we all have to deal with, internal, external, and cosmic or philosophical. And so today, Jesus is going to help us deal with that. I put this up on the internet last week because this is kind of what we're going to do. We're doing religion versus love. Jesus paints us a religion versus love picture in the reading that we had this morning. It's a question of rules, because you are supposed to bring an offering, but you are supposed to reconcile with other people. So just to refresh your memory, this is where we're going to start. And this is quite an amazing thing that Jesus said here. If you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Now that's, to my mind, that's quite an amazing thing for Jesus to be claiming on behalf of Almighty God for this person who has come into the temple to bring their offering before God. To say, listen, if you're in the middle of bringing your offering, and you remember that somebody else, there's a rift in a relationship with somebody, what you need to do is drop that wherever you're standing and go back and take care of the rift, take care of that broken relationship, and then come back and bring your offering. And this helps us. It helps guide us through all three of those kind of levels. You've got the external issues, kind of just bringing the offering, and you've got the rift with another person. You kind of have the internal problem of, I want to do what's right, so what's right here? And I think a lot of the times that's one of the internal problems we face in our life. What's right here? What's the right thing to do here? And then, of course, this particular situation also involves kind of the cosmic, the problem of our relationship with God and how that works. And so, what we're going to look at, we're going to try to use what Jesus said here to sort out how to figure out what the right thing to do is in different situations in our lives. In this instance, it's how do I balance between religious duty and relational reconciliation? Now, Jesus often uses hyperbole to make a point. You remember the famous one that everybody quotes, why do you try to get a speck out of your brother's eye when you have a log in your own eye? Nobody actually has a log in their eye. It's a point. Jesus is using hyperbole to make a point. You pick an extreme situation. You pick an extreme situation and things become more clear. So here's an extreme situation. Someone is walking up the altar with their gift, and it occurs to them that they have this unreconcilable thing with their brother. And Jesus says, even in this extreme situation, here's what you do. Here's where your priorities lie. And the reason Jesus says this is because it's easy for us to kind of, rules are more restful. You don't have to think about rules. You don't have to consider rules. Rules also allow the hierarchy to kind of control things. And so there's that bit too. But what Jesus is calling people back to is that it's never been about the rules. It's the rules, the law, all the things, do this, don't do that. Those all have a basis in something deeper. And understanding the deeper thing is how we're going to be able to take whatever the Bible says and apply it to brand new situations that the Bible doesn't address. And what Jesus is calling people back to, the primacy of love, has always been the teaching of the Scriptures. It's always been the teaching of the Scriptures. Hosea, Old Testament prophet, I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. There's a primacy to love And this is the way the rules work, is the rules are there to help us grow in love, never to pull us in a direction that is unloving. And Jesus was on about this all over the place. His disciples were walking through a field one time, and I might be conflating two different episodes, so if you're like a Bible scholar, you catch me, I'm admitting this up front. But my recollection is Jesus would walk, his disciples were walking through the field, and they grabbed a few heads of grain, and they kind of rubbed them together to get the seeds off, and they threw them in their mouth. Well, and that was the Sabbath, and what they were doing, according to the very technically reasoned out rules, was working on the Sabbath. They were preparing a meal on the Sabbath. That's what the Pharisees said. They were really all about the rules. And Jesus said, listen, I mean, he probably went like this. The Sabbath was made for man, he said. Not man for the Sabbath. The Sabbath, the idea of taking a day off, is not to create a burden for you. It's to create a blessing for you. Which one of you, if your donkey falls into a pit on the Sabbath, says, well, I guess I gotta wait till tomorrow because it's a Sabbath? Of course not. You rescue, you get your poor animal out of the pit. The rules are for us. The rules, the Sabbath, everything else, all these things are to be a blessing to us, not a cage to constrict us, to make us live inside of it. And so what we're talking about today is if you want to do well in life, this is one of the things you have to understand, is you have to be able to, I'm not telling you to disregard the rules, and Jesus isn't telling you to disregard the rules there. He doesn't say forget the gift. He says just get things in order. Just get them in order, okay? First things first. And first thing is the love. And then the religious duty, the religious obligation, all of those things, are supposed to support that. Because rules can work for a while sooner or later, but you're going to encounter situations where the rules don't apply anymore, right? I mean, because Jesus lived 2,000 years ago in the Middle East. And you and I, we don't live 2,000 years ago in the Middle East. So there's no rule about setting the thermostat, because there was no thermostat to set. There's no rules about how to drive in the New Testament or the Old Testament, because they didn't have to do that. You don't have to have rules about how to drive. You don't even have to have which side of the road to drive on if all you're doing is walking donkeys down the road. So we have a lot of applications to do. And to take those rules and apply them today, what we have to do is peel them back and get beneath them. And that's what Jesus is calling us back to today, is to peel those rules back and get deeper, so that we can live well today beyond whatever the specific rules of the Bible are. So I want to call you back for a moment to the passages that we read. And I just want to look at those for a moment. There was passages about anger and lust and divorce and oaths and retaliation. So, the anger one. This is the command is do not murder. And Jesus says, I say to you, everyone who's angry with his brother is liable to judgment. If you insult your brother, you're liable to a counselor. And if you say, you fool, then you are liable to the hell of fire. That's pretty strong words. Hell of fire, I think. So what's he doing here? What's he doing with this? He's pushing on us. He's if the rule is just don't murder, you can live a perfectly selfish life and never murder. If that's what God is getting at, you can live a perfectly self-centered life and never murder. But that's not what God is getting at. Because Jesus said all the commandments are an expression of only two. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. And so there's something more than don't murder. Lust. You've heard it said don't commit adultery. But I'm saying to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. And then he says, if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away, for it is better that you lose one of your members than your whole body be thrown into hell. Let's call that hyperbole. Hyperbole is overstating a case to make a point. However, just because something is hyperbole doesn't mean it's not true. Right? So just because something is hyperbole doesn't mean it's not true. And so here, yes, in fact, if you were at the door to heaven, and there's like a, you're walking, I don't know, whatever picture you want to paint in your mind, right? There's a door to heaven, and there's someone standing there, and they say, you know what, I'm going to let you in, but you got to get rid of your right eye. Who of you would get rid of your right eye? I would. If that's the choice, so that, see, it's a hyperbolic choice for us now, but it's also a very, very true choice. And then divorce, and then oaths, and then retaliation. You've heard it said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I'm saying, don't resist someone who is evil. If someone slaps you on the one cheek, turn to them the other. There's some cultural things in there, but I don't want to go into that today. What I want to point out is that when we look at the law, don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't swear by God's name, don't retaliate. When we look at the law, it gives us a minimalist letter of the law kind of way of being. And whenever you look at things and rules as sort of if you're looking at just that simple rule and that's what you need to do, you can bend that to your own advantage. You can still be your own person. You can take that rule and try and manipulate your life and people around you within the rules so that you still come out on top. And when you do that, love has not won. And so when you do that, you have not been following what's underneath those commands, which is love your neighbor as yourself. And that's what Jesus is getting at, is that, listen, all these things, you've heard it said, don't lust, don't commit adultery, murder, these things, they come out of a bigger command, and that is to love people. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. The second is like it. You should love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments, all the law and the prophets depend. You shall not murder. You can not murder someone and still not love them, right? I mean, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but that seems like sort of the low bar for loving your neighbor, doesn't it? Don't kill them. Right? That's a pretty low bar for loving your neighbor. Don't sleep with someone you're not married to. That's a pretty low bar for being faithful to your spouse, don't you think? We don't have to go back to the book about faithfulness, you know. Anyway, I hear brother. So the point is that these commands are meant to drive us to love. And what Jesus says when he pushes on these commands is, if you take them as long as I get over this command, I'm okay, you're missing the whole point. Because this is the command is to love your neighbor as yourself. And what we find, if you read through the Bible, what you find is that whenever somebody actually thought they were doing these things, Jesus gave them something more to do. There was a guy who approached Jesus and said, "Teacher, what must I do to gain eternal life?" And Jesus said, "You know the commandments. Don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal, don't murder." And he's like, "I've done all that since I was a kid." And he thinks he's got it. He thinks he's actually earned his place in heaven. And Jesus says, okay, well, you lack one thing. You need to sell everything that you have and come and follow me. Whenever anybody thought they were earning their way into heaven, Jesus pushed on them until they could not earn their way into heaven. And so we read these rules about murder and stuff like that, And then we read what Jesus does to them, like kicking it up to 11, and then he takes the bar and puts it unreasonably high. And there's two things that this does for us, two things it does for our lives. The first thing it does for our lives is something every one of us needs, and we need it over and over again because we're broken, and God wants to drive us to himself. These drive you into the mercy of God. They drive you toward God's mercy. Now, you may not have a problem with anger where you feel like killing somebody. You might have a problem with lust. Or you might not have a problem with lust. You might have a problem with greed or selfishness. But no matter which one you pick, Jesus is going to raise the bar, raise the bar, raise the bar until you realize that that's not the way God thinks. That you need God, the forgiveness that God gives us in Jesus Christ. Because in Jesus Christ, God flips the whole thing around and says, this is not a relationship of criminal and judge. He says, I want it to be a relationship of father and child in Jesus Christ. That's what God has done for us. And if he didn't do it, we'd go through our whole lives measuring ourselves. And I don't know about you, but for most of us, going through a whole life measuring ourselves is going to suck the joy right out of our lives. It's when you don't have to measure yourself that you're most at joy. It's when you don't have to measure yourself that you're most at peace. Think of your best friends, the ones you really like to hang out. Those are the ones where what? It's where you can be yourself. You don't have to measure your words. You don't have to choose your vocabulary. You don't have to think about what you're going to say before you say it. You're just relaxed because you know the relationship is based on love, not on the rules. And so that's what Jesus does with these things. When he pushes and pushes and pushes, he says, listen, go ahead, try the rules. Keep pushing on them, because sooner or later you're going to find out you can't do them, and you're going to say, God, have mercy on my soul, and now you're where you need to be. There's an old joke, and it goes like this. A man died and went to heaven, and he was a good God. And he got to heaven at St. Peter's at the gate with his iPad. And he looks at the guy's file, and the guy says, hey, look, heaven. Peter's like, yeah, it's heaven, and I want you to come in. And the guy's like, okay. And Peter says, we just have this little test. And if you get 100 points on it, you're in. And the guy goes, what? And so Peter starts going, I said, looking through his life, and I see, and he says, I see that you married to one woman for 57 years and never cheated on her. That's excellent. That's worth a point. Because, perks up a little bit. I said, wow. You went on a mission trip to Guatemala 3 times? I'll give you 0.5 for that. Wow, you were an over-tither? 11.3%? I'll give you another point for that. And by this time, the guy's like freaking out, right? Because these are the 3 big badges of his life, and he's got 2.5 points. It's like, Peter, what am I going to do? The only way I'm going to get in is through God's mercy. And Peter's like, yes, come on in. And that's what God is trying to do to us. That's the first thing with the way he pushes on the commands, is he wants to restructure our relationship and have us quit measuring ourselves like that. Because that's not the relationship we have with God. In Jesus Christ, God has become our Father. And he desires the very best for us. If you had kids and all they ever did was shoot for the low bar of your standards instead of trying to live out family life, it'd be horrible for you. And that's not what God wants for us. He wants a great life for us. So, the first thing is to drive us into God's mercy. And we need that. Because that's the only way we're going to feel whole. It's the only way we're ever going to actually have peace. The peace doesn't come from living well enough. The peace comes from realizing that in Jesus Christ, God has quit counting. God has quit counting. And if Jesus has to make you feel like crap to get you to quit counting and rest in God's mercy, then that's what he's going to do. And maybe that's what you need to do today. Maybe you're walking around measuring yourself. Maybe you're walking around trying to figure out if you're enough. You're feeling like you're not enough, or maybe you are feeling enough today. So today's the day to hear Jesus push on these commands in an unreasonable way to get you to quit thinking that way and to think of God as your Father instead of the guy with a big checklist. to drive you into His mercy. The second thing they do for us is this. They lead you to respond to God's love by seeking life as it's intended, not meeting some minimum requirements to satisfy a rule, but letting God reorient your life. When Jesus says, "You've heard it said this," that's the bar, "but I tell you this," he's not moving the bar, he's saying, think differently about your life. Think differently about your life, because they're all the commandments are based in love God and love your neighbor. And so it's not, what can I get away with, but how can I love my neighbor? How can I love my wife? How can I love the people in my neighborhood? Not what can I get away with, but how can I be the best? How can I be the most loving? How can I be the kindest? Jesus wants us to completely move the needle on our lives, not just find a new set of rules. There's a story that came across the internet this week. And here's what happened. There was a policeman, and he just wanted to get his record added or something. But he found this guy one day, and he planted evidence on him and got him falsely convicted of drugs, possession of drugs, and the guy went to jail for 4 years. A few years later, the policeman got found out and got fired and ended up working at this, it's a Christian ministry that has an outreach portion and also has a coffee house. And so he's working at the coffee house. Guess who else? The guy that he got wrongly convicted also ended up working at the coffee house. He got out when it turned out that the guy admitting he's a forged, he had falsified his evidence. So he ends up working at the coffee house. And guess what happens? Forgiveness. You can't make that stuff up. The story goes on. It's their faith in Christ that leads them to, instead of count things, to just reorient their whole life around the love of Christ. And now they're friends. Now they are good friends. They hang out together. They do ministry together. Can you imagine? The policeman who set the guy up and the guy who went to prison for 4 years on a false charge becoming friends. That's what God wants the world to be like. Not just, oh, I didn't murder anybody. Oh, I didn't commit adultery. He wants it to be an amazing place of love and reconciliation. That's what Jesus wants life to be like. And so that's the other thing these things do for us when Jesus pushes on them so hard, is to just, instead of saying, what's the bar here, to say, what's the goal here? Instead of, what do I need to do to stay within the lines, what's the goal? And the goal is love. So, maybe you need to be driven a little harder into God's mercy. Maybe you need to quit looking at what the low bar is and reorient your life toward love. These are what Jesus called us for, his death and resurrection. And let's take a moment to pray about it. Father in heaven, you sent your Son to live, to die, to rise again as our Savior. And you have shown us in him that you love us enough to die, and that you have the power to rescue us even from death itself through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We see Jesus pushing on those laws up to unreasonable standards. Let us take those so seriously. Let us just take what Jesus said really seriously, so that maybe some of us here today need to be crushed. Maybe we just need to feel the weight of our lack of living up to God's standards in any real way. Maybe we just need to be crushed into power today. Because I know that is the path to life, Lord. That being crushed by the weight of the law is actually what frees us. Because then we turn to God for mercy and we receive it. Give that to us today as we celebrate the Lord's Supper. And also, help us reorient our lives. Help us not to ask the question, what does the rule say here? But what does love call me to do here? Help us to do that, Father, in Jesus' name. Take a short break to bring up the prayer cards and the offerings. Again, if you want us to pray up, you need to pray out loud with the prayer card here. Otherwise, everything else goes in the offering plates. And I got some questions for you to think about, or even talk about if you want to. One is, do I need to be driven to despair in some way today? Number two is, where am I trying to hold on to my own way and meet that minimum bar rather than letting God reorient my life to shoot at the target of love? And number three is, do I have a spiritual growth habit that would allow God to daily influence my life? Because we need that constant. We need to be like the little chicks continually following the mother duck, even when things blow us around. We just look up, follow Jesus again, and keep going. So Matthew's going to play a song for us. And feel free to get up and stretch and move around and bring your stuff up, and we'll reconvene to celebrate the Lord's Supper in about 4 minutes.
Perfect, no, 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 no
Let's stand as we begin our celebration for the evening. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
God the Father, we confess our sins to you and to one another.
We have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have sinned in what we have done
and by what we have failed to do.
We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
If we have earned your love and sufferings,
we know we will be lost forever.
Forgive us,
renew us, and lead us,
so that your will is our life.
Our Heavenly Father sent His Son to proclaim the time of His favor, the forgiveness of sins. Jesus, the promised Savior, was born, lived, died, and rose again. He proclaimed forgiveness of sins for all who believe. Therefore, hear this now and trust it as from the very mouth of Jesus Himself. Your sins are forgiven. You are right with God through Jesus Christ. Let your hearts be at peace. Please be seated.
Thank you.
and read these.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, one holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Please stand to pray as we pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
Father, we come to you with the stuff of our lives. And it's a great comfort to know that we come at your calling. We want to pray for healing for Chet from cancer. We also want to pray for someone who's struggling with drug and alcohol kind of addiction. We ask you to give freedom to that person. We want to pray for continued healing for Chris's arm and healing for Andrea, who's battling breast cancer. We want to lift up prayers for Courtney and for Tiffany. That you would comfort them in their loss of their family. We pray for the growth of our congregation, that we can welcome more people into your family here at Journey of Life. We continue our prayers for Jeff, who is going to Shands for further diagnosis. Father, give the doctors clarity on both his illness and the treatment path that will bring him to wholeness. We want to pray that you would give patience and understanding to caregivers, loved ones who have someone in their lives with Alzheimer's, and also pray for peace for those people with Alzheimer's. We pray for good results for Phil's test tomorrow. Father, just let that little procedure go very well and do exactly what it needs to do to resolve his swallowing problems. We want to pray for quick healing for surgery that's happening on Wednesday. Stephanie, also we want to pray for guidance with career directions. We want to pray for daily, we want to thank you for the improvement you've given for Kay with her back surgery and ask you to speed her along around the healing and give her patience to be able to rest when she's supposed to be resting. Father, we want to pray for health and healing, also for Brad Tibbs and Donna Olmsted and John Burkhoff. We want to pray for our servicemen and women overseas and all our first responders, that you keep them safe, not just in their body, but also in their spirit, as some of them have to engage in violence as part of their We pray for people undergoing persecution for their release. We pray for persecutors for repentance. We pray for the brothers and sisters in Christ that they would have that miracle testimony of love even toward those who are harming them. We pray for local ministries, for Fears Like Their City, for Princeton East, for Kairos, for the Central Florida Children's Home. We pray for workers that are close to our mission workers, Tom and Merrill, William and Grace, Michael and Ann, David and Ruth. We also continue our prayers for healing for Michael and Ann's grandson, Luke, that you would bring him through all the treatments, a complete healing of his brain changes that we've never seen that thing again. We want to pray for Barbara and Ralph suffering from dementia and also for their family members to have peace. And we also pray for continuing for healing for Frank's headaches. Lord, and we just ask you to work in there to minimize and take these headaches around the world. And we pray for people who don't know you, people who are still setting a bar on themselves and on others. And they don't know that you have done everything in Jesus. And that now we live as children. Let our congregation and indeed all your Christians everywhere be actively open to sharing the love that you have shown us in Jesus.
in whose name we pray the prayer of this cause. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples. And take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And the same way also after supper, he took the cup, and when he gave thanks, he passed it to his disciples, and said, drink of this, all of you. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Now may the peace of the Lord be with you all of us.
And also with you.
Celebrate this supper. Thank you that in Jesus you have done all the rule keeping that ever needs to be done. And now through him, we are your sons and daughters. Father, every time we catch ourselves evaluating our worthiness, call us home to your love in Jesus Christ. Reorient our hearts so that we receive your love, peace, and reorient our hearts so that when we look at those around us and the world, instead of putting bars up for them, place ways for them to measure up, that we look on them with love, and we reorient our lives around love in every circumstance because of what you've done for us in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Welcome to the Lord.
This is the body. This is the blood. Broken and poured down.
My hunger and thirst.
us pray. We give thanks to Almighty God that you have reached out to touch us with your love, that you have not left us with the illusion of living lives good enough to be worthy of your perfection, but you have gone above and beyond that to love. You've shown your fatherly love for us in Jesus Christ, and you call us to go above and beyond that in our relationship with the world. Help us to move the needle away from rule following toward love as we look at ourselves and as we look at the world. Teach us what it is to live in love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A couple of announcements. Our quarterly mission focus, we will just start doing our best to get more first-time visitors. We've had 4 so far. We want to get at least 16 by March 31st. So whatever you can do, I have more cards here that you can carry around and just give to people. Whatever else we can do. Potluck brunch today. We'd love for everybody to stay. Even if you didn't bring something, we always share everything we have. It's the way of Christ. So please stay. Ash Wednesday service, confirmation today for confirmation students. Ash Wednesday service is at Mike and Leanne's home. They live here in the neighborhood, and there'll be more information about that later on. Just want you to know that that's coming up here in a few weeks. So, any other announcements? Linda already had a chance for yours.
No, I'm just astounded at how much our Panera Bread supplied today, because we have very little left, and that means you don't have to cart at home.
Excellent.
For the Prince of Peace for tomorrow.
Any other announcements?
Yeah. For the next couple weeks or so, I'm not going to be much help breaking down after service, because I'm going to have a procedure on my knee, so if you feel so compelled to stay afterwards and kind of help pack up all the gear and load it on the truck, that would be great.
Any other answers? Let's stand up and sing our closing.
Now
of your life around love for God and all of the other creation.
Amen.